Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from John Russell and Anna Matteo. Later, Brian Lynn has this week's technology report. Finally, we hear the first part of our U.S. National Parks series. Today, we visit Theodore Roosevelt National Park in North Dakota. But first,
the Galapagos, a group of islands in the eastern Pacific Ocean, are coming under increased pressure. Observers say climate change and invasive species threaten wildlife on and around the islands, which are part of the South American country of Ecuador. Warming ocean waters affect the food sources of many of the sea animals around the Galapagos. Marine iguanas are one of many species that are unique to the Galapagos. The reptiles have a harder time finding the food they prefer, red and green algae. A recent Associated Press, or AP, report said sea turtles struggle to nest in warmer temperatures. Raising young gets harder as water warms and fewer nutrients are available. We have something of everything here. That's why people say the Galapagos is so diverse. But we have a small number of each thing, said Natasha Cabezas, a naturalist guide. The Galapagos Islands are famous for animals that were studied by Charles Darwin in the 1800s. He developed the theory that living things change over large amounts of time. The group of islands is where major ocean currents meet: cool water from the south, warm water from the north, and a cold current from the west. In addition to those, there is El Niño, the periodic and natural Pacific Ocean warming that affects weather worldwide. While temperatures depend on the season and other natural climate events, scientists say ocean temperatures have been rising. They blame climate change caused by human activities. Some scientists say the ocean has reached its warmest level since at least the 1800s within the last 10 years. The U.S. space agency NASA says 2023 was the ocean's warmest year on record. In the southern hemisphere, June is the first month of winter. One of the ocean currents, the Cromwell Current, brings sea creatures like whale sharks, hammerheads, and sunfish to the surface. It also provides nutrients for penguins, marine iguanas, and sea lions in search of food. Scientists are studying how the past year's El Niño affected those creatures. El Niño can bring food shortages for some species, like marine iguanas and sea turtles. Scientists observing the species have noted a decrease in their populations during El Niño events. Marine iguanas were one of the most affected species from El Niño last year, and right now they are still recovering, said Galapagos Conservancy Director Jorge Carrion. As rising ocean temperatures threaten sea life, on land there is a different problem. Animals, cats, dogs, pigs, goats, and cattle, none of them native, are threatening the unique species of the islands. After the COVID-19 pandemic, many people left dogs and cats they had been taking care of, Cabezas said. If you don't take care of them, they become a problem, and now it's a shame to see dogs everywhere. We have a big problem right now. I don't know what we're going to do, she said. The non-native animals are a special threat to the giant tortoises of the Galapagos. The tortoises almost disappeared in the 1800s because of hunting. Officials have tried to protect them from humans. It has been illegal to kill a giant tortoise since 1933. In one night, a feral pig can destroy all nesting sites in an area, Carrion said. Park rangers try to visit areas with nesting sites once a day and kill pigs when they find them. But the pigs are difficult to find, Carrion said. Feral cats feed on young marine iguanas, and both pigs and cats compete for food with the tortoises. Plastic is also a widespread problem in the world's oceans. One recent study reported microplastics in the bellies of Galapagos penguins. There are no animals in the Galapagos that do not have microplastics in their food, Carrion said. I'm John Russell.
For many years, cups of instant noodles have been a favorite among Korean Air passengers. However, they will no longer be available for economy class travelers starting August 15th, said a spokesperson for the Seoul-based airline. Korean Air said its decision was a safety measure to deal with increased turbulence aimed at preventing burn accidents. Turbulence, or irregular movements from up and down air currents, can cause the hot cups of noodles to spill. In addition to regular meals, instant noodles are currently part of Korean Air's self-service food for economy passengers on long trips. In this week's announcement, the airline added that it will offer other food items for economy travelers. The new offerings include sandwiches, corn dogs, and hot pockets. However, business class and first class passengers will still get their noodles. Korean Air told the BBC that the noodles are brought individually to business class and first class travelers. This reduces the risk of spills and burns. Concerns about the dangers of serving hot food and liquids on airplanes is not new. Over the years, several airlines have faced legal actions from travelers who say they suffered serious burns after having hot coffee, for example, spilled on them during a flight. In 2019, the European Union's highest court ruled that an airline can be held responsible if a passenger is injured in this way. This is the case even if turbulence or other flight-related reasons did not cause the spill. But turbulence, of course, still adds to the risk. Flying through unstable air can make balancing something, like hot soup or drink, much more difficult. Several turbulence-related injuries have been reported over the years. But most injuries are minor. And airlines have made continuous improvements in reducing the number of in-flight accidents. Those include stopping service when needed or taking extra care when giving out certain drinks. Still, rough air might be getting harder and harder to avoid. Weather and airline experts note increasing reports of turbulence. They point to the possible effects climate change may have on flying conditions. I'm Ana Matteo.
An American judge has ruled that Google violates U.S. trade laws by operating its search engine as an illegal monopoly. The ruling accuses Google of paying smartphone makers to ensure that Google's search engine is set as the default system on new devices. The U.S. Justice Department brought the antitrust case against Google's parent company, Alphabet. U.S. District Judge Amit Mehta said his decision took into account all evidence and statements presented during the trial, which ended in May. When the first part of the trial ended, it was up to Mehta to decide whether any of Google's operations were illegal. Mehta wrote in his ruling, "Google is a monopolist, and it has acted as one to maintain its monopoly. Technology experts have estimated Google enjoys control of about 90% of the online search market and about 95% of smartphones." A recent study by the California-based investment company Bond found that Google's search engine processes an estimated 8.5 billion requests per day worldwide. That result was nearly double the number of daily search requests recorded in 2012. Google's online advertising business helps fuel the majority of Alphabet's $307 billion in yearly revenue. The ruling could open the door for a second trial for the court to establish ways for Google to fix its operations to obey current laws. Some experts say one possible fix could be for Google's current business structure to be broken up. Such changes could greatly reshape the current systems for online advertising. Alphabet criticized the court's ruling and said it plans to appeal. "This decision recognizes that Google offers the best search engine," the company said in a statement. It added, however, that the ruling does not permit the company to make it easily available. U.S. Attorney General Merrick Garland called the decision a historic win for the American people. He noted, "No company, no matter how large or influential, should remain above the law." White House Press Secretary Karine Jean-Pierre called the decision a pro-competition ruling and a victory for the American people. She said she believes all people deserve an internet that is free, fair, and open for competition. In explaining his ruling, Mehta noted Google had paid $26.3 billion in 2021 alone to make sure its search engine was included as the default system on smartphones and browsers. Such payments, the judge wrote, have permitted Google to keep its strong market share over worldwide internet search. Keeping the default position represents a huge business advantage for Google over its competitors, Meta added. The judge noted that under the current system, it would be nearly impossible for any other company to secure the same kind of default agreement with smartphone makers. Such a deal would require a company willing to pay partners upwards of billions of dollars in revenue sharing, Meta said. Discussions in court about how Google's operations should change are set to begin on September 6th in Washington, D.C. The ruling is the first major decision in a series of cases brought against big technology companies in recent years, including Google, Apple, Meta, and Amazon. Those cases involve antitrust, privacy, and other issues. I'm Brian Lynn.
Brian Lynn joins me now to talk more about his technology report. Hi, Brian. Thanks for being here.
Sure, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
This week, you reported on an American judge's decision to declare Google a monopoly because of its search engine business. I'd like to discuss some terms we heard in the report that might be new to our listeners. Let's start with monopoly.
Yes, a simple definition of this word would be complete control of the whole supply of goods or services in a particular area or market. In the report, the judge describes Google as a monopoly because the court feels the company's business has an unfair advantage over its competitors. The term also carries legal weight, with monopoly describing unlawful business methods. And in addition, we could use this term as a verb. An example of this would be to say something is being monopolized, meaning complete control is being seized over something.
The report points out the government's argument centered on Google's search engine being included as a default choice for new smartphones and other devices. Let's talk about that word next.
Sure, yes, default is a word we hear often in technology. A basic definition would be what exists or happens normally if no changes are made to something. The word is important in this case because it describes factory settings put in place by smartphone manufacturers. So the default setting on such devices is set to be Google's search engine because it is already on the device. A user would have to make a change to remove this as the default.
Okay, thanks again for joining me, Brian, and thank you for that report.
You're welcome, Ashley. Thank you.
Woodrow Wilson, America's 28th president, established the National Park Service in 1916 to protect the wild and wonderful landscapes in the United States. But it is an earlier leader who is considered the father of America's national parks. In 1906, Theodore Roosevelt, America's 26th president, signed the American Antiquities Act. The law permitted him and future presidents to take immediate action to protect important cultural or natural resources. The Antiquities Act led to the creation of many of the 413 sites within the National Park Service today.
No president has played a bigger role in protecting the country's natural and cultural resources than Theodore Roosevelt. During his time in office, he established 5 new national parks and 18 national monuments. In all, he protected over 93 million hectares of public land. He became known as the conservationist president. Roosevelt's concern for the land and environment came from the time he spent in the Dakota Territory, beginning in the 1880s. The area where he traveled is now the state of North Dakota. Today, you will find a national park there named in his honor. The park protects badlands, wildlife, scenic views, as well as 2 ranches where Roosevelt himself once lived. Welcome to Theodore Roosevelt National Park.
Theodore Roosevelt came to Dakota Territory in September 1883. He was a young married man from New York, where his political career was just beginning. He came to Dakota in hopes of hunting huge animals called bison. He also had a great interest in the Western frontier lifestyle. Roosevelt soon developed an interest in raising cattle. Cattle ranching in Dakota was a big business in the 1880s. Cattle fed on the land's healthful grasses. He and a partner entered the business. Roosevelt invested $14,000 to build the Maltese Cross Ranch. Roosevelt returned to New York while workers constructed the ranch. He resumed his political duties in Albany, the state capital. But in early 1884, he experienced 2 great personal losses. His mother and wife died of illnesses on the same day, February 14th. Roosevelt described the pain and loss in his diary with only 1 sentence: "The light has gone out of my life."
Roosevelt again headed west in the summer of 1884. He sought to escape the reminders of his recent losses. He arrived at his newly built Maltese Cross Ranch. He also decided to build a second ranch in a quieter, more remote area. He called that ranch Elkhorn. Roosevelt traveled between New York and Dakota, working both as a state lawmaker and a cattle rancher. In late 1884, he helped form an organization in Dakota to help protect ranchers' rights. In 1885, Roosevelt published his first book about his experiences as a rancher and hunter. In it, he predicted that the cattle industry of the Dakota Badlands was not sustainable. In other words, it would not last. Roosevelt was right. Severe weather struck the area in 1886 and 1887. In the winter, a terrible freeze killed many cattle. The animals that survived the cold soon starved.
Roosevelt himself lost over half of his cattle. He decided to get out of the business. The experience, however, shaped Roosevelt's beliefs about the need for conservation in America. Those beliefs, in turn, helped shape his policies as president.
Visitors to Theodore Roosevelt National Park can experience the Badlands just as Roosevelt did hundreds of years ago. They can also visit the Maltese Cross Cabin, as well as the Elkhorn Ranch area. The park has three main areas: the South Unit, the North Unit, and the Elkhorn Ranch Unit. In the South Unit, visitors can drive along the Scenic Loop Road. It offers many places to see wildlife and the surrounding Badlands. Badlands are very dry places with little vegetation. Wind and water shape Badlands mainly through erosion. The process leaves behind high, flat-topped hills of clay and other soft rock. Many visitors stop to look at Painted Canyon. It gets its name from the colorful exposed rocks there. Trails near the canyon offer visitors a chance to see animals, from the huge American bison to small black-tailed prairie dogs. These animals are not really dogs. They are rodents. Roosevelt described prairie dogs as the most noisy and inquisitive animals imaginable.
The North Unit also offers several hiking trails. Some paths are short and easy. Others may take 2 days to complete. The Achenbach Trail is a 28-kilometer-long path. It crosses the Little Missouri River and takes visitors into the heart of the Theodore Roosevelt Wilderness. The third area of the park is the Elkhorn Ranch Unit. This is what Roosevelt described as his home ranch. He wrote of the ranch in this way: "My home ranch house stands on the river brink. From the low, long veranda, shaded by leafy cottonwoods, one looks across sandbars and shallows to a strip of meadowland, behind which rises a line of sheer cliffs and grassy plateaus."
Today, the Elkhorn Cabin itself no longer stands. Visitors will find only stone rocks where the cabin once was. The area that surrounds Elkhorn, however, is among the most beautiful, wild, and quiet places in the Badlands of North Dakota. It is this peace and beauty that appealed to Roosevelt after the deaths of his mother and wife. But the Dakota Badlands did more than just help Roosevelt overcome his pain. They helped shape the kind of president he would later become. In the words of Roosevelt himself, "I would not have been president had it not been for my experience in North Dakota." I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm John Russell.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.